Hey guys, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Dental Pathshala where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And most of you have been through in the age of 20 to 25 that pain and swelling because of the third molar, because of the impacted third molar. And when you go to the dentist most of the time prescribe you to go for the extraction. So today's video we are going to talk about the impacted teeth. So we are going to talk about what is the sequence, which is the most common impacted teeth, what do you mean by impacted teeth, and what is the treatment for the impacted teeth. So without further ado, let's get started. Before we get started, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our future videos. So today's topic is the impacted teeth. Impacted teeth is very easy. Now you all must have heard of, because you all must have gone through the 20-25 years of age, and in that age most of the time the third molar is impacted. As you know that it is trying to come out, as it's fighting hard with a bone, it is trying to come out, but it is unable to come out, and at the last we have to go for the extraction because there is no space either, or it cannot come out. So today's topic is that only. We are talking about impacted teeth, not only the third molars. So the most common actually impacted teeth is the mandibular third molar. After that, maxillary third molar. After that, maxillary canine. So like that, we will also discuss the sequence of the impacted teeth. But before that, we are going to talk about what is the impaction. How did this impaction happen? What is the reason for impaction? See, this is very easy. The most common thing is that because there is no space. But because of this reason only, we are just stretching it, reading the theories, reading the definitions. So this is very simple topic actually. When the tooth is not able to come, this is called impacted teeth. For that we have to read, because this is important for a theory point of view. So this is the reason we are studying it in the similar fashion that we are studying according to the theory. So everything I'm going to just write down for you guys so that you can understand it better and you can write it for your exams. See, understanding impacted teeth is very easy. The teeth which is not able to come out is the impacted teeth. A reason can be because there is no space. The treatment is we have to get it extracted. So we are going to just roam around the bush and we are going to read lot of things in the impacted teeth. So this video we are going to talk about the definitions, the indication, contraindication, the etiology, what is the cause, and cause in that we will be reading about the theories and all. Okay, next video we are going to talk about the classification, and then next to next video we are going to talk about the treatment. So we are going to divide in 3 or 4 parts. So talking about the impacted teeth again, why does this happen? See, the tooth eruption. Back to basic. Always back to basic. What happens? This is a primary teeth. We are talking about the eruption, tooth eruption sequence, right? So we have here the erupting tooth in the bone, which is the pre-eruptive stage. Then we have the intraosseous stage, right? When it is inside the bone. So suppose this is the... Sorry, you guys cannot see. So this is the, suppose this part is the soft tissue. So this is the pre-eruptive stage. Then we have the intraosseous stage. Then we have the mucosal stage, where the teeth is inside the mucosa. So then we have the, after mucosal stage, then we have the pre-occlusal stage. So basically it is not an occlusion, but you can see it clinically in the mouth. Then we have the occlusal stage and then the maturation stage. So this is how the tooth eruption happens. So talking about the impacted, see, there are three things. One is the impacted tooth, another one is the unerupted tooth. The difference between impacted and the unerupted tooth is that impacted tooth will not be able to come out no matter what you do. Okay, so the eruption is lost, that is not going to come out. Either it is partially. See, that is not the thing that you cannot see the impacted tooth. You can see the impacted tooth, but it is not going to come into the occlusion. It is not going to come in its correct position. But if you look at the unerupted tooth, then maybe the eruption is delayed for some period of time. But that tooth is going to, that is able to erupt. And that can be erupted. That is the unerupted tooth. Malposed teeth, on the other hand, the third thing is that which is erupted in some other location, some abnormal location. We can say the labially placed canines. That is an example for a malposed tooth. So impacted and unerupted tooth are actually different. So impacted teeth is basically the tooth that has failed to erupt either completely or it has failed to erupt partially in the dental arch. And its eruption potential is lost. It will not be able to erupt. But if we look at the unerupted teeth, it is that tooth in the which is in the process of eruption. It is going to come out, but it is not. It has not come out right now, which is the unerupted teeth. And it is likely to erupt. In the future, it is going to erupt is the unerupted teeth. So talking about the today's topic, which is the impacted teeth. So impacted teeth, impaction is a Latin word which means impactus. So impactus means an organ or a structure which because of any abnormal condition is not coming to its normal positioning. So this is same goes for the impacted teeth, because this impacted teeth is not able to come out to its normal position, not able to come out to its occlusive position, occlusion position. So this is the impacted teeth. So we will be discussing four definitions we have here. The first definition is by Rounds in 1962. It states that condition in which a tooth is embedded in the alveolus. Alveolus is the bone. And so that its further eruption is prevented. So it is so much embedded into the bone that it is not going to erupt. That bone is preventing its eruption, according to Rounds. Then according to Archer in 1975, it states that a tooth which is completely or partially unerupted and it's positioned against another tooth or the bone or the soft tissue. See, not only the bone is restricting it, sometimes it can also be the soft tissue. It can also be such a hard lining of the soft tissue. It can be such a hard lining of the mucosa that the mucosa is restricting its eruption. So not only the bone, also it can be the soft tissue. So that its further eruption is unlikely, that is, it is not going to erupt. Then we have the Anderson in 1997. It is the cessation of the eruption of a tooth caused by clinically or radiographically detectable barrier. So we can see that clinically or radiographically detectable barrier means we can see the bone that it is not letting its eruption in the path of eruption or by an ectopic position of the tooth. Ectopic position means that it is not going to erupt in its previous position or in desired position, in the favorable position. It is going to erupt somewhere. It is going to be either inclined somewhere like that. So coming to the last definition, that is the Patterson. There are more definitions, but we are covering the four definitions. So Patterson is a tooth is considered to be impacted when it has failed to fully erupt in the oral cavity. So when it is not fully erupted, it can be partially erupted also. So when it has failed to fully erupt into the oral cavity within its expected developmental time period. So within its time period of eruption, it is not erupting it, and it can no longer reasonably be erupted to do so, and we are not expecting it to erupt. We know that it is not going to erupt is the impacted teeth. So I hope that now you guys are clear with the definition. Rounds, Archer, Anderson and Patterson, we have covered four definitions. Basically, this impacted tooth is the tooth which has failed to erupt either completely or partially. It is not erupted to its occlusion level. So this is, and it is not going to erupt also. This is the impacted teeth. So talking about the most commonly impacted teeth is the mandibular third molar. Now you can remember it as, because the mandibular bone is the dense bone, right? Dense cortical bone. So because of the density of the bone, because the bone is so dense that the tooth cannot come out. So this is not, see this, you can remember this, that mandibular third molar, then the maxillary third molar, then the maxillary canine, then mandibular premolar, maxillary premolar, mandibular canine, maxillary central incisor and the maxillary lateral incisor. See, remember this, maxillary lateral incisor is the least, because it is not impacted. Actually, the variation or the disturbance you can see in the maxillary lateral is in the shape. So it can be the peg shaped laterals. So like that. Okay. So the impacted, if we talk about, is the mandibular third molar. So we have the theories of impaction given by Dirbeck. So see, there is a nature and nurture hypothesis which states that, given by the John Hunter in 1771, and he states that this increase in the size of the brain at the expense of increase in the size of the jaw. That means he says that now in the modernization, the jaw size is decreasing and the brain size is increasing because people are chewing less. So because of the less use of the jaw, this jaw size is decreasing. So we have the theories of impaction. So first theory is the orthodontic theory. So as the orthodontic forces, see, orthodontics actually concerns with the development, growth and development of the jaw, right? So the jaw develops in the downward as well as the forward direction. The growth of the jaw is mostly in the forward direction. But what happens when there is a small jaw? When there is a small jaw, then there is going to be the decreased space. There is no space for the mandibular third molar. And this density of the bone of the jaw decreases the movement of the teeth in the forward direction. So this result in the less size, the small jaw, the decreased space. Then we have the phylogenic theory. So phylogenic theory says that the nature, it tries to eliminate the disused organ. So whatever organ, like appendix, whatever organ we don't use, so actually nature is trying to eliminate that organ. And due to the nowadays, due to this nutritional habit, due to the habits, because due to this refined food, because of the fast food, because we are not using the jaws as the ancients used to use. So because of this practice, because we are not using the jaws, then this is the reason that nature is trying to eliminate that. So this jaw is decreasing in the size over the centuries. If we look at, there is a decrease in the size of the mandible, and this is the reason that there is no space for the mandibular third molar, or we can say that there is a insufficient room for the third molars. So this is the reason, the phylogenic theory. Then comes the pathological theory. So basically this phylogenic theory is more functional. The more the masticatory forces are, there is going to be more development of the jaw, according to this theory. But since we are not using this masticatory forces a lot, so this is the reason that there is less development of the jaw. Then coming to pathological theory. So pathological theory is actually not a kind of a normal theory, because as the name suggests, pathological. So in case of certain diseases or in case of certain infection, there is condensation of the bone. So when there is condensation of the bone, then the bone is not letting the growth of the third molar. Then comes the Mendelian theory. So Mendelian theory is always the hereditary theory. So because Mendelian theory is related to the hereditary transmission. So what it states that, suppose the mother is having the small jaw and small teeth. Likewise, the father is having large jaw and large teeth. So the small jaw is coming from the mother, large teeth are coming from the father. So there is going to be a discrepancy in the space, and there is going to be the impaction of the teeth of the third molar. Then comes the endocrinological theory. So endocrinal theory states that because there is less secretion of the growth hormone, so there is going to be a reduced in the jaw size. When there is a reduction in the jaw size, then there is less space. When there is less space, then there is impacted teeth. See, but let me tell you one thing. This is not only the bone which is not letting the teeth coming out, also sometimes you can see the operculum. Operculum is basically when the tooth is coming out, there is soft tissue layer. So sometimes there is a dense fibrous tissue covering, you can see in the distal surface of the second molar. So this operculum is usually seen in the erupting third molars. Sometimes it is not always the bone which is not letting the teeth out. Sometimes it is also the soft tissue abnormalities. Sometimes it is because of the soft tissue reasons that the tooth is not coming out, because there is a hard soft tissue layer which is not letting the tooth out. So one example for that can be a gingival fibromatosis. In that case, the tooth, or any dense soft tissue is there. In that case, the soft tissue is not letting the tooth erupt. So coming to the causes. See, it can also be the ankylosis when the cementum is fused with the bone. There is no PDL. So this can also be one of the causes. And any obstruction in the eruption. So it can be either due to the compact bone. So we are talking about the causes of infection, impaction according to the Berger. this is not the burger of McD. So local causes, it can be the local cause or the systemic cause. Local cause can be obstruction of eruption. There can be any obstruction due to the bone, any obstruction due to the soft tissue. So it can be either the compact bone, it can be either the dense soft tissue, either it can be the premature loss, gingival fibromatosis, if there is any cyst is present. Also it can be the ankylosis of the jaw. It can be also any change in the angulation of the teeth. It can also be any chronic inflammation. If there is decreased jaw size, then also there is going to be the impaction. If there is any irregularity present of the neighboring teeth, of the adjacent teeth, then also there is going to be impaction. So basically, if we see, the local causes are the obstruction of the eruption. Is there is any obstruction in the eruption path? There is any lack of space. When the jaw is small, teeth are big, there is any lack of space. If there is any ankylosis of the teeth, in case of any ankylosis of the teeth is there, the cementum is attached to the bone, then there is no PDL, tooth cannot come out. So that can be also a cause of impaction. Non-absorbing alveolar bone, if the bone is letting the teeth come out, if there is any ectopic positioning of the tooth bud, if the tooth bud is positioned in such a manner that it cannot come out, if there are dilacerated roots. So dilacerated roots are a sharp bend in the root. So the dilacerated root are like this. So if any this is a dilacerated root, a bend in the root. Also when there is a soft tissue or the bony lesion is present, then also the tooth cannot erupt. Coming to the systemic cause, any cause which is related to the systemic. So it can be the prenatal cause. It can be prenatal cause, can also be the Mendelian, if you remember, the hereditary cause. So this is a hereditary cause. Then we have the postnatal. Postnatal we have, like after the birth, what happens when the jaw is not able to erupt properly, when the jaw is not able to develop properly. That cause can be either the rickets, congenital syphilis, it can either be the malnutrition or anemia. So also the endocrine disorders, in which there is decrease in the growth hormone, it can be a cause, because when the jaw is small, the teeth, there is no space, and it can also lead to the impaction. In cases of some disorders or some conditions like cleft lip, cleft palate, in case of cleidocranial disorder, in case of osteopetrosis, in case of achondroplasia. So because of these causes, there is an impaction, and there are certain problems which are related to the, if the impaction tooth is retained for a long time, then it may develop in some problems. Now, because you guys are also been through this age, and you must have experienced by your own a case of any impacted teeth. So in any impacted teeth, basically what is going to happen, there is going to be the swelling of the same side, ipsilateral side. Swelling will be there, pain will be there, lymph node enlargement will be there, and you will have difficulty in the swelling. Also some thick mass, we can say pericoronitis, so that also is sometimes there, and because of that there is going to be the bad smell, bad breath. So like that, you must have experienced it on your own. So there is going to be the pain, difficulty in mastication, you won't be able to chew properly because of the pericoronitis and because of the operculum. So any swelling of the retromolar tissue region will be there, which is the pericoronitis. Again the flap will be there, and soreness, you will feel the pain in that particular side of the jaw. And also there will be arrhythmia of the overlying soft tissue. So when you see this arrhythmia of the overlying soft tissue is the operculum. So this is the operculum, and there is going to be difficulty in opening the jaw, which is going to be the trismus. Then the facial swelling will be there on the same side. Space involvement we have already studied in the space. See, all of the spaces are actually related with the third molar. So this is the mandible, then we have the meseter, then we have it here, this side, the medial pterygoid. So this is our fascia. So what happens, there is going to be the mesenteric space infection, there is going to be the pterygomandibular space infection, also there is going to be the buccal, and in third molar you can also face the temporalis space infection. So and it can go from the pterygomandibular space up to the para. It can go from the pterygomandibular space, it can go up to the parapharyngeal space, right? And also it can go descend down retropharyngeal, then it can go to the mediastinum and go to the thorax, that we have already covered. Space infection of the mandibular third molar. we have covered in a separate video. If you want to watch, you can watch that video. So also there is going to be the raised temperature. See, there is going to be the inflammation. Whenever inflammation happens, there is going to be redness, which is seen in form of the operculum. So there is going to be the redness over the soft tissue. There is going to be the erythema of the soft tissue. Then we have Reuver tumor, dollar calor. We'll have redness, we'll have pain, we'll have swelling. And also there is going to be the fever. There is going to be raised temperature. So all of the signs of inflammation you have to write in this. Then the regional lymphadenopathy. Because the space infection is spread by the lymph, right? Lymphatic spread. So there is going to be the lymphadenopathy of the specific region. Also, because if this tooth is partially erupted in the oral cavity, so it is there, it has been there for quite a long time, then what happens? Because we are not able to clean it properly, so the dental caries occurs in that case, because we are unable to clean it. And also there are risk of the cyst and tumor development, which is seen associated with the retained impacted teeth. So in the retained impacted teeth, we will see the pain, Reuver tumor, dollar calor. So redness, swelling, pain, and we can see the raised temperature. Along with that, pain. See, pain is going to be in the affected area. If it is right side, then the pain is going to be in the right side. Then the lymphadenopathy is going to be in the right side. And the space infection is going to be in the right side. So this is how it occurs. So the ipsilateral side is going to get affected. And also because of the operculum, because of the periconitis, there will have a difficulty in the chewing, difficulty in the mouth opening. So basically we are going to do the extraction. Where are we going to do the extraction? Where we are not going to do the extraction? Let's just discuss it. So indication is when there is a fracture. See, suppose there is a fracture. And when the tooth comes in between the fracture, then that time we extract the teeth when there is a recurrent pericoronitis. So pericoronitis is basically inflammation of the flap which is covering the tooth. So that case, if in case the infection is keep on coming, then also we go for the extraction when there is a deep periodontal pocket is present. Prior to any orthodontic treatment, in case you are recommending any patient for ortho treatment, every time you are going for the OPG, right? And whenever you are going for the OPG, every time you are going to, first thing you are going to do is getting the scaling done. Also, as well as the ortho, you are going to extract the impacted teeth. Any retained deciduous teeth is there, then also you go for extraction. Management of the cyst and tumor, then also. Management of the pre-prosthetic surgery and prophylactic removal. And if we talk about indications for extraction according to Peterson. So, Peterson says that the prevention of the periodontal disease. If you want to prevent any periodontal disease, then also you extract the impacted teeth. If you want to prevent the caries, then also you extract the impacted teeth. Even if you want to, either you want to prevent as well as in case you want to treat the periconitis, recurrent periconitis, then also you are going to extract the impacted teeth. When there is a root resorption, you want to prevent the root resorption, then also you extract the impacted teeth. Whenever you want to prevent any or treat any cyst and tumor, then also you extract these. Then coming to the contraindications. So if we are talking about contraindications, there are two contraindications. One is the local contraindication and then the systemic. So in the systemic also we have absolute means never ever think about it. Absolute. Relative means yeah, you can do it. Okay. Coming to the local contraindication. So local contraindication is when there is an adequate space is present, right? So don't mind with the spellings. So whenever there is space is present. Whenever we want to use as the abutment teeth, when the tooth is present in the tumor, is asymptomatic, when it's not showing the symptoms of impaction, then there is no requirement actually. You can also keep it in case of any acute infection, because you are letting the first infection subside, then the LA will also work and then you are going to extract the tooth. In case of any, see, this is very important. In case if a patient has any recent irradiation treatment, then you cannot go for the extraction because it is going to do the osteoradionecrosis, because the bone is going to die if you are going to extract it immediately after the radiation therapy. So then comes the systemic. See, in the systemic, there are many things. First of all, we will talk about the relatives. So relatives is when there is an uncontrolled diabetes. When there is an uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, so in that case, you can first make it controlled diabetes. So you can make the patient come to the normal values, normal sugar, and then you can extract. Same goes for hypertension also. You can let the patient come to the normal blood pressure and then you can extract. In case if there is any MI, see if you remember, within the 6 month of MI, actually MI is, see, within MI is an absolute, but after 6 month it can go to the relative also. So in case of any cardiac diseases, in case of any liver dysfunction, in case the patient is having steroid treatment like my mom. So in case of any blood dyscariasis, any anticoagulant therapy also. Any pregnancy. See, pregnancy in the first and third trimester goes to the relative. Then again, because you are not going to extract it. This is the contraindication. Remember this. This is the contraindication. Then also chemotherapy. Coming to absolute contraindication, wherein whatever happens, you cannot extract the teeth. You are not going for any surgical procedure. That is in case of leukemia. In case of hemophilia. Basically any coagulative disorders or MI, recent MI, you cannot extract the tooth at all. So these are the indication, contraindication. We also covered the definition. We have also covered the causes or etiology and also the theories involved in the etiology. So this video we have covered the four definitions, the round, Archer, Andreessen and Peterson definition, and also we have covered the most sequence of impacted teeth. So the most commonly impacted teeth is the mandibular. Always remember the mandibular third molar. You can remember it as, because it is dense bone. And then the maxillary third molar. And then the maxillary canine. So this though you remember this at any case. And then we have the mandibular premolar. Then the maxillary premolar. Then the mandibular canine. Then the maxillary central and maxillary lateral. So this is the sequence. Also we have studied the theories of impaction. Orthodontic theory, phylogenic theory, pathogenic theory, Mendelian theory, endocrinal theory. And the local causes and the systemic causes we have also covered. And the problems, basically what happens, main symptoms are rheumatoid, dolor, calor, always remember. So pain, temperature, increased temperature will be there, raised temperature will be there. Then pain in case of patient won't be able to eat properly and patient won't be able to open the mouth properly. So like that, pain will be there. Difficulty in mastication, difficulty in mouth opening, all that will be there. Soreness will be there. Then there is going to be swelling in the retromolar tissue. So just behind the third molar, there is going to be a lot of swelling. And also there can be also facial swellings. It is mostly associated with the facial swelling also. And it is associated with the space involvement and also lymphadenopathy. So all these are, and in case if it is partially erupted for a long period of time, then there can also be the caries. So these are also the indication, contraindication, the problems, the causes, and etiology and definition of the impacted teeth. Next video, we are going to talk about the classification of the impacted teeth. So if you liked the video, enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up. You can also comment in the comment section below. And guys, subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss any of my future videos. And in the description below, now you have a chance to support me on the Paytm and on PayPal to make free videos for you guys and to make free notes. Thank you for that. See you soon. Take care, guys. Keep reading. Keep studying. I will see you soon. Ta-ta.